Ibn Khaldun, The Introduction to History. In this lecture, we consider the question of history as discussed by Ibn Khaldun, a scholar of the 14th century. Born in North Africa, Ibn Khaldun was a public figure, serving various rulers in North Africa from Fez to Cairo. As a scholar, he was interested in history, particularly the history of tribal peoples, Arabs, Berbers, and Turks, and their role in human civilization. He was also a pious Muslim with mystical leanings. Above all, he was a keen observer of human society, having spent time among tribal peoples as well as in ruling courts. He is best remembered for the lengthy introduction he wrote for his world history, known simply as The Introduction, al-Muqaddima in Arabic. In it, he spells out a theory of history. He considers human societies, both nomadic and settled, and the factors that allow for dynasties to come to power and the reasons that bring about their decline and demise. For him, history has a logic, observable patterns, laws, and he sought to understand them. This is a question for every era, including our own. What is history and how does it work? In one sense, we think of history as a record of facts about the past. For example, during the night of December 25, 1776, George Washington crossed the Delaware with the Continental Army, surprising the enemy encamped at Trenton. That's a fact from the past. But history is also a set of memories. Memories of losses we mourn, memories of victories we celebrate. We remember how those people from across the sea colonized us and brutalized us and exploited us. We remember how our forefathers heroically resisted and eventually triumphed, freeing the land from the grip of the foreign occupier. In this sense, as memory, history is never neutral. We always take a side. However, Ibn Khaldun was first and foremost interested in the forces of history. What drives history? What allows some people to come to power, flourish, and prosper, while others decline and fade into oblivion? How does history work? Is it a question of morality? Do good things happen to us because we're good? Bad things happen to us because we're bad? Is that what drives history? To look to a people's morals to explain their history is not as foreign to us today as it might sound. In the United States, certain religious figures, Pat Robertson and Jerry Falwell, attributed the 9/11 attacks to America's moral degeneracy. It was our own moral failings that had caused these attacks. In this view, bad things happen to nations that fail to live righteously. Is that how history works? The moral character of a people as the cause behind the events of the day? Or is history better explained by socioeconomic and political factors? One nation is conquered by another because it does not have a large agricultural base and therefore cannot extract from its farmers sufficient tax revenues to fund a sizable army to ward off the encroachments of foreign powers. Still others might argue that it is God who makes history happen. God sends a prophet with a message to a nation, and it is in heeding the message of their prophet that a people become strong and prospers, and in neglecting it that they become corrupt and lose their purpose as a people. This would be to identify the logic of history with God's ways. This would be to suggest that a society is unable to prosper without the guidance of religion. How are we to understand history? As a record of past events, or as the arena in which traces of divine providence can be detected? Ibn Khaldun lived in a politically precarious time when dynasties came to power through sheer force, one strong man with a tribal backing ousting another in a never-ending cycle of power politics. In the 14th century, the abode of Islam had fallen under the sway of a highly ambitious warlord by the name of Timurlane, master of one of the largest land empires known to history. He was successor to the new order that the Mongols had established in the abode of Islam. The Mongols, a tribal people under the rule of Genghis Khan, arose out of the Far East in the 13th century and spread westwards. Under the command of Hulagu, a grandson of Genghis Khan, they would conquer the central lands of Islam, including Baghdad, the seat of the caliphate and symbol of the sovereignty of Islam. The Mongols would become Muslim, but their conquests, along with the end of the caliphate in Baghdad, provoked considerable soul-searching in scholarly circles. Was the abode of Islam no longer under the guiding hand of God, or was it now subject to the whims of world conquerors such as Timurlane? What was it that ruled the abode of Islam? Sharia, as taught by scholars, or the calculations of conquest? Timurlane was supportive of scholars such as Ibn Khaldun. Ibn Khaldun actually met more than once with Timurlane outside of Damascus as the world conqueror laid siege to the city. In one meeting, Ibn Khaldun declared to Timurlane that he, Timurlane, was living proof of the conclusions that Ibn Khaldun had reached about the workings of history, dominated, as he saw it, by tribal groups whose cohesiveness and solidarity gave commanders the military force they needed to conquer on a wide scale. And, Ibn Khaldun assured Timurlane, no one since the time of Adam and Eve had been as successful as he in harnessing the forces of history. However, Timurlane was better known for his cruelty. He is famous for having towers built out of the skulls of his victims. It would be easy to conclude that life in the abode of Islam in the age of Ibn Khaldun was determined by the dictates of power, not the ways of God, but the ways of vicious tyrants. At the same time, Christian powers from Europe had begun to make incursions into North Africa and exert control over its commercial life. Moreover, those ruling over North Africa, although Muslim in name, were no more than petty dynasts in pursuit of their own worldly interests, willingly allying with Christian infidels against fellow Muslims. Ibn Khaldun, a keen observer of society, tried to make sense of all this. World conquerors riding roughshod over the abode of Islam, infidels playing Muslims off one another. Was it the law of the jungle that drove the history of Islam? Ibn Khaldun also knew personal loss. His parents fell victim to the plague, and his wife and children perished in a shipwreck as they traveled from Tunis to join him in Egypt. Were the faithful not under the protection of divine providence? Where was God's guiding hand amidst the political hardball and personal tragedies of life in this world? Had God abandoned his faithful servants to the world and its ways? The realities of the day prompted Ibn Khaldun to think deeply about the workings of history. Shouldn't it be the moral teachings of Muhammad, not power politics, that drive the history of Islam? In other words, the politics of the day posed a theological challenge for Ibn Khaldun. He was concerned to address a political situation that made it seem that God's ways were no longer operative in the abode of Islam. He beheld the realities of his day and was led to ask the theological question, are God's ways still what define the abode of Islam? This remains a question today. Awful disasters happen. Hurricanes and tsunamis strike down scores of innocent victims, to say nothing of man-made catastrophes, and people ask, where is God? Where is God in the midst of all this? Ibn Khaldun, in his own day and in his own way, posed this question. How was God's promise of victory to his servants to be understood? Here we need to ask, what does Ibn Khaldun's interest in the workings of history have to do with the basic beliefs and practices of Islam? When we think of the basics of Islam, we think of the five pillars of Islam, the testimony that makes one a Muslim, whereby one declares that there is no God but Allah and that Muhammad is his messenger. Then ritual obligations, prayer daily, almsgiving annually, fasting during Ramadan, and pilgrimage to Mecca if one is able to do so. And then there are the core beliefs of Islam, belief in Allah and all the scriptures and messengers, culminating in the Quran as revealed to Muhammad, as well as belief in the angels, the day of judgment, and recognition that God decrees all things, both good and bad. What does inquiry into the workings of history and patterns in society have to do with Islam's basic beliefs and practices? What does history have to do with God and the message of God to humanity as communicated to Muslims in the Quran? Ibn Khaldun took a highly sociological approach to explain history. This makes it easy to overlook the theological side of his writings. He explains history in terms of power politics, but he also makes it clear that God's providence is still at work in the world, but not in any obvious way. Rather, he argues through the naturally occurring processes of human society, in the very forces that bring groups to power. Ibn Khaldun came up with a theory of history that recognizes the reality of power politics, but that also sees in them traces of divine providence. Ibn Khaldun begins by focusing on tribal life. He argues that human civilization starts from tribal life. This might seem odd, since we often associate civilization with urban centers, and many of Islam's scholars would balk at the idea of the desert as the source of civilization. Hadn't the Quran criticized Bedouins for stubbornly resisting the faith? Hadn't Muhammad called his followers to immigrate to city centers such as Medina to live out the ways of Islam in society? Ibn Khaldun in no way denied the religious history of Islam, but he also saw history in terms of sociological processes, including the way in which tribal peoples emerged from the desert steppes to conquer urban centers, not to destroy but to renew them with the moral vigor characteristic of desert life precisely at a time when the luxuries of city life had sapped the spiritual strength of society. How did it all work? In tribal life, groups seek to maximize their interests at the expense of others. They conduct raids on settled peoples to acquire material possessions and also to assert superiority. As Ibn Khaldun observes, tribes exhibit a drive to superiority over others. What allows tribal groups to come to power is something he calls asabiyya, group solidarity, a natural readiness to sacrifice and fight for the group. This solidarity, asabiyya, is what makes a tribal group self-reliant, without need for a political power to protect it or promote its interests. Also, Ibn Khaldun argues, this self-reliance, the byproduct of life in the harsh desert climate, makes tribal peoples more virtuous than city people simply because they are far from the corrupting trappings of city life. Because of the nature of life in the desert, tribal people, in contrast to city people, have no time for luxuries which only corrupt the soul. Tribal peoples are wholly occupied with the struggle to survive. This strengthens them in fortitude and makes them independent. In their hardiness, they have no desire for the niceties of city life. They do not hire servants to do their work or soldiers to defend them. In other words, they are self-governing, whereas city people live under the governance of their rulers and, as a result, are gradually stripped of their own fortitude and become increasingly independent on others to protect them and secure their interests. In addition, tribal peoples, because they are uncorrupted by the luxuries of city life, more readily internalize the teachings of religion. Religion, like rule, is a kind of governance, with a set of laws to order relations in society. However, in contrast to the rule of a political power, religion is a kind of governance that comes from within. It is not external to one's soul as political power would be. Religion, in this sense, is about self-rule, whereby one governs one's life by inner conviction rather than being coerced into disciplined order by external power. As such, religion serves the same ethical purpose as the rule of a political power, namely to regulate behavior. But unlike political power, it does not strip people of their fortitude and self-reliance, and, as Ibn Khaldun argues, because tribal peoples do not know outside political control, they are more naturally disposed to receive religion not as external dictates, but as strengthening internal mechanism. As a result, religion works to enhance group solidarity, consolidating a group's sense of superiority and enabling it to unite other groups under the banner of its emergent sovereignty. In other words, religion allows a tribal group to expand its sway and to assert its mastery beyond its tribal homelands. And so a tribal group, through a combination of virtue, solidarity, and piety, transforms into a royal house whose ability to conquer distant lands makes them builders of empire. However, once in power, the tribal dynasty becomes accustomed to the luxuries of courtly life. Subsequent generations no longer remember the toughness of their hardy tribal forebears, who emerged from the desert to conquer other peoples and establish their tribe as royal sovereign. The descendants of the dynasty's founders come to think of rule as theirs by right. They do not realize that the acquisition of sovereignty involves struggle and sacrifice and a resistance to luxuries. On the contrary, their desire for luxuries only grows stronger, leading them to extract more and more tax revenues from the farmers, merchants, and craftsmen who make up the economy of their realm. As a result, people move to other lands where they can more fully enjoy the fruit of their labor. All this erodes the economic basis of the dynasty, leaving the rulers with diminished tax revenues to pay their servitors, the ministers and secretaries who manage the realm, and the soldiers who defend it. Within a handful of generations, four according to Ibn Khaldun, the dynasty has lost its fortitude and group solidarity and is no longer able to defend itself or even to pay others to do so, making it ripe to be overthrown by another tribal group that is closer to the virtue, solidarity, and self-reliance of desert life. In other words, unjust rule, tyranny, does not last. A dynasty comes to power, gets used to luxuries, extracts more taxes, and so destroys the economic basis of their own rule. In a phrase, if you're not ruling justly, you bring about the demise of your own realm. This is not to speak of a democratic check on bad rule. There were no popular elections at this time. Rather, a natural system dictates the prosperity of rule and its long-term sustainability. The problem is that a ruling dynasty invariably grows corrupt, and so will inevitably be overthrown by another group not yet corrupted, but still in the upward swing of its drive to superiority. For Ibn Khaldun, history is a never-ending cycle of the rise and fall of dynasties. A tribal power rises to sovereignty, but is then weakened by the forces of corruption that, according to Ibn Khaldun, are intrinsic to city life. The first generation, still imbued by desert life, rules virtuously. They are not tempted by the luxuries of the court, but still prefer the toughness of desert life to the ostentations and extravagances of the city. Their descendants inherit power, but become corrupted because they do not know the life of the desert. Eventually, another tribal group arises to replace them in a never-ending cycle, the rise and fall of dynasties. Again, what does all this have to do with Islam? Is Ibn Khaldun describing the world, human society, and its ways? Or is he describing God and God's ways? Is his approach to the study of history sociological, or is it theological? What is the object of his inquiry into human history? Is it society, or is it God, or is it both? Here, once again, we stand at the crux of theohumanism. In other writings from this course, we consider naturally occurring processes in the soul that act as God's way of guiding us. The power of the mind, for example, as seen in the story of Hayy ibn Yaqsan, Alive, Son of Awake, by Ibn Tufail. Here, we're looking at naturally occurring processes in society that might tell us a bit about God and God's ways. Ibn Khaldun offers perspective into theohumanism at the macro level of society as a whole. How does it all work? How is it that Ibn Khaldun looks at the ways of human society, which he explains in highly sociological terms, and yet understands them as God's ways? Amidst his highly sociological discourse on the rise and fall of dynasties, he has this to say: "This is God's way of proceeding with the world." The phrase in Arabic is sunnatullah, God's way of proceeding. His sociological analysis is meant, then, to cast light on God's customary way of dealing with the world. What kind of scholar is Ibn Khaldun? Is he a secular scholar, trying to understand the ways of the world on its own worldly terms, as some claim? Or is he a pious scholar, seeking traces of divine providence at work in society, even if operating through society's own natural mechanisms? And why does he link the sociological and the theological? After all, one need not speak of the rise and fall of dynasties and attribute it to God. This, of course, is the point of theohumanism. It shows us how theists and non-theists are not separate species, but actually think alike, only differing in the ultimate meaning they attribute to the workings of the world. Does one need to refer to God to draw lessons about the morality and immorality of history? One may be able to explain history without reference to God, but Ibn Khaldun compellingly argues one cannot explain it without reference to morality. Significantly, Ibn Khaldun explains the very origins of Islam in the 7th century according to his sociological method. This is remarkable. It makes it seem that Islam spread not according to divine will but natural processes. He says, "A religious message will not spread if not backed by a group of solidarity. You need a tribe to support you if you're going to be a successful prophet." In other words, to succeed in the world, religion needs to tap into sociological realities. The call of Muhammad succeeded, Ibn Khaldun explains, because it tapped into the energies of tribal solidarity in its day. In turn, the message of the Prophet, the holy person, works to enhance group solidarity. This, Ibn Khaldun says, is exactly what happened at the origins of Islam. Tribal groups that supported the call of Muhammad were able to unite and undertake the conquests that brought far-flung lands under the rule of Islam and great wealth to its coffers. But what happened? They conquered, took over the cities, and got used to their luxuries, and opened the door to the cyclical forces of history. The first Muslims, Ibn Khaldun insists, were not above the forces of history. They too became victims of their own success. The first generations, the rightly guided caliphs, were closer to desert life, and so ruled virtuously, but their descendants soon became enamored of the wealth that fell to them, leading to the erosion of the moral fortitude and solidarity of the first Muslims. It was thus inevitable that another tribal power should come to the fore, driven by its own group solidarity, and this, Ibn Khaldun says, explains the rise of the Umayyads, who replaced the rightly guided caliphs. But they, too, would succumb to the forces of history. They, too, got used to the luxuries of their courts and pleasure palaces, leading to the erosion of their group solidarity, and so the Umayyads came to be replaced by the Abbasids. Islam, too, is not immune to this cyclical view of history, one dynasty replacing another. Ibn Khaldun applies his sociological analysis to the very origins of Islam. By the time of Ibn Khaldun in the 14th century, Muslim scholars have been writing history for several centuries, but they viewed history from different perspectives. All sought to explain how God's purposes are accomplished in the world, God's purposes, as set out in the Quran, being justice and mercy. However, some scholars gave more weight to the role of heavenly sent prophets in explaining how God's purposes come about, while others gave more weight to the role of worldly rulers. The first group saw God ruling history in a more direct way, by sending prophets with a message for their peoples. Rulers come and go, but the real driving force of history is prophecy. It is the message of prophets that lasts and that therefore should be obeyed. Indeed, for some scholars, prophets were sent not only to dole out moral advice from on high, they and their caliphal successors were meant to rule. The second group, however, while not dismissing the importance of prophetic teachings, placed more weight on worldly rule, strong governance, as the force that brings about God's purposes by establishing justice and creating prosperity in society. For this second group, history is less about prophets and more about sultans who rule wisely, but also forcefully, bringing about order and stability in society and ensuring that all members of the community know their place and also enjoy their basic rights. Ibn Khaldun was heir to both these understandings of history, but he brought new insight. Perhaps he was prompted to think in a new way because he realized that the earlier models of historical thinking no longer worked. After all, God had sent prophets, but the world was as topsy-turvy as it had ever been. The prophetic message was important, but there was little evidence that it alone explained the workings of history. After all, Ibn Khaldun notes, history offers examples of peoples that had not received a prophetic message but still flourished. In other words, while Islam's Sharia might enhance the moral welfare of a people, informing them of their otherworldly interests no less than their worldly ones, history shows that a simple implementation of Sharia is not necessarily the key to imperial success. Also, one could not hang the hope of civilization entirely on the shoulders of rulers. Rulers did exhibit traits of justice in their dealings with their subjects, but they governed largely according to their own interests, happily wiping out whole peoples in cruel fashion as Timberlane did. And dynasties came and went. Power was a key driver of history, but it was also highly precarious. It was therefore also not quite right to look to power alone to understand the deepest impulse behind the workings of history. Ibn Khaldun made the bold argument that society has a life of its own, that there are patterns in human history even aside from the messages of prophets and policies of sultans, and that these patterns demonstrate a moral order by which God governs the world. One need only observe the patterns of history to see that those in power become corrupted, only to be replaced by groups whose moral vigor remains strong. This cycle ensures the continuity of a moral order amidst ever-changing politics. This, however, was no secular viewpoint. Indeed, Ibn Khaldun seems ultimately to have been inspired by the narrative of the Quran. Among its different themes, the Quran recounts a story of nations, the rise and fall of nations, but it does not explain how the process works. In scripture, God is depicted as controlling everything, supporting his loyal servants, and bringing destruction to infidels who neglect to render thanks to God as source of all blessings. In other words, the Quran, as scripture in general, does not describe history in terms of naturally occurring processes in society, but in terms of God's power over creation. For example, the Quran speaks of ruling councils that are destroyed or fall from power for rejecting the prophets God sends them. They arrogantly turn from God's message and lead their peoples astray, and so God brings about their demise. This is called in the Quran Sunnatullah, God's way of proceeding with the world. For example, in the 35th chapter of the Quran, known as Al-Fatir, the Creator, the 43rd verse mentions Sunnatullah, God's customary way of dealing with the world. The Quran has this to say, "Arrogance in the land and the plotting of evil. Evil only surrounds evildoers. You will not find any change in the way of Allah, and you will not find any alteration in the way of Allah." The point of this verse is that when people do evil, it only comes back to them. The Quran might mean that in terms of Judgment Day in the next world. Do evil here, and it'll catch up to you on Judgment Day. But scholars like Ibn Khaldun assumed real-world implications. The Quran notes that rulers disobey God by rejecting their prophets, who call them to reform and to rule with righteousness, and this brings about their downfall. But the Quran doesn't explain the processes by which they meet their demise. Does God just zap them when they go wrong? Or is there a natural causality to Sunnatullah? How exactly does Sunnatullah work? What are the dynamics of this scriptural concept? God sends a message with a prophet, worldly powers fail to pay heed, and so are destroyed, only traces of their past glory remaining as a warning for posterity. So that's Sunnatullah. But how does it work observably? What are the social and political factors that bring about the downfall of a ruling dynasty? Statements of scripture need to be explained, not just repeated, and this is where we see the intersection of sociological analysis and theological reflection in Ibn Khaldun. What the Quran describes simply as God's way of proceeding with the world, Ibn Khaldun explains in sociological terms. How can naturally occurring processes in society explain Sunnatullah? This offers important insight for Theo Humanism, which looks to the human as object of theological reflection, but is never divorced from scriptural insight. Here, in the case of Ibn Khaldun, we see a scholar who is struck by a scriptural narrative, but notices that it is left unexplained, and so he seeks to explain it in the context of his own day and according to the scientific insights available to him. In other words, the case of Ibn Khaldun suggests that scripture is to be read for questions as much as for answers. For Ibn Khaldun, the question was, how can we think of Sunnatullah in real time? How can Sunnatullah be understood in terms of the workings of history? Is it about religious teachings, political success as reward for pious devotion? Is it simply chance, the fickle finger of fate, some lucky, others not? A random tsunami comes along and wipes a people off the map. Is that God's customary way of dealing with the world? Ibn Khaldun was very sensitive to the logic of power politics, as we have seen. He could not explain Sunnatullah in terms of religious teachings or in terms of random instances of fortune and misfortune. He saw patterns in society, a system representing the laws of history. But he also asked what such a system might tell us about God. To put it another way, how do we go from life in the desert steppes, with its harsh struggle to survive, to the heights of civilization, where rulers dole out justice, build walls for the city to fend off marauders, finance public works, bringing about prosperity, but also engage in drinking parties, grow corrupt, and eventually succumb to another tribe in quest of superiority? And what does all this tell us about God's ways? The politics of the world may be in constant flux, but Islam's teachings remain, embodied in the concept of Sunnatullah. Ironically, the key to Sunnatullah lies in the logic of power politics. This is not to equate Sunnatullah with power politics, but rather to say that something about power politics offers hints about God's way of proceeding with the world. How does a tribal group come to power, emerging out of the desert steppes to conquer land and claim sovereignty, only to be weakened by the luxuries of city life and within a few generations succumb to yet another tribal group arising out of the desert? And how does that indicate that God's ways are at work in the world? There is much to consider in the writings of Ibn Khaldun. It will be important to read the Muqaddima for yourself in order to appreciate the nuances of his thought. Here, we have seen that Ibn Khaldun does explain history in terms of power politics, in line with his own real-world experiences. But he also realizes that real politique alone is not enough to explain the workings of history. There is also a decidedly moral aspect to history. It is not simplistically mechanistic in the sense of those who saw America's moral failings as the cause behind 9/11. Rather, Ibn Khaldun realizes that there is a system in place, a naturally occurring system, in which rule is determined as much by its moral character as by the power it holds. A group comes to power as a result of its moral fortitude, the byproduct of the simplicity of its desert life and group solidarity. But it loses power as a result of its loss of this simplicity and solidarity and its unquenchable thirst for luxuries. This makes sense. Power falls under the weight of its own corruption. It also echoes the narrative of the Quran, which praises righteousness and condemns corruption. In other words, Ibn Khaldun has explained the moral vision of scripture in terms of naturally occurring processes that drive history. Real politique is involved, but so are moral concerns. Indeed, if you want your rule to last, you must heed the laws of history no less than the warnings of scripture. Ibn Khaldun is thus suggesting that God's ways are accomplished through the natural forces of history. It is not simply real politique, one tribe trying to maximize its interests at the expense of others. The prosperity of a dynasty is not simply a question of power, it is also a moral question. The city, which is the place of corruption, will inevitably be renewed by the moral fortitude of tribal groups. Civilization endures not because of the achievements of city life, however grand they might be, but because of the moral fortitude that is natural to tribal groups. Here, in the view of Ibn Khaldun, the desert is actually the source of virtue. It is there, in nature, that people more readily cultivate inner fortitude, the result of having to struggle for survival and rely on themselves, combined with the religious impulse. In contrast, the city is the milieu of immorality and corruption. How is God's way, Sunnatullah, to prevail when things seem so bad? God is not coming down from his throne to intervene directly. Ibn Khaldun's cyclical interpretation of history is a way to explain how God's ways prevail, how city life, despite its own inherently corruption-inducing ways, is ceaselessly renewed and reinvigorated by values inherent in non-citied life. Civilization at its center is always reinvigorated from the margins. To give a very imperfect analogy, here in the United States, one group of immigrants grows old and gets replaced by new groups of immigrants. There is a cycle at work. America's original immigrants no longer rule. Influence increasingly lies with new groups that bring a new vigor to American life. Groups in American history come and go, but America remains. This is what Ibn Khaldun is saying about Islam in his cyclical view of history. Dynasties come and go, but Islam remains. While humans become corrupt, Sunnatullah remains operative. While urban life invariably corrupts its newcomers, leading to their demise, hope remains for moral renewal from the margins of society. This is God's customary way of dealing with his creation. This is Sunnatullah in rationally comprehensible terms. Divine providence is at work in the world, but not so obviously. Groups come to power driven by a desire for superiority, but there is a morality to the process. They only succeed because others have become corrupt, and indeed they too only prosper to the extent to which they live and rule righteously. What Ibn Khaldun wants to say is this: the world may not be perfect, but the way it works reflects the message of the Quran, namely, that moral goodness prevails, while corruption is wiped away in the end, even if this is not immediately apparent. Ibn Khaldun has explained Sunnatullah in his day. The world seems uncertain, politically precarious, and it is. But amidst it all, one can still catch a glimmer of divine providence. The traces of God's care for the world can still be detected in the transformations that society constantly undergoes. The strength of civilization is ultimately bound up with morality and resistance to the luxuries of city life. Islam carries both the scriptural mandate for humans to maintain authority over the earth and the internal restraint necessary for civilization to avoid its own destruction. One can expect that even amidst the precarious political climate, the forces for truth are still at work. God does act in human history, but not obviously. Ibn Khaldun's thought is thus equally grounded in the Quran and his own sociological observations. This makes him a Theo Humanist, whereby he explains the ways of God according to natural occurring processes. In this, there is a message, even for us today, when we sometimes wonder where God is amidst the unhappy politics of the day. Even if it is not always obvious how God is at work, with a little humanist reflection, we might be able to detect traces of Sunnatullah concretely at work in society. With Ibn Khaldun, we might see that God is guiding us through the very processes of our own world.